Thank y'all for being with us here today. I want to start out by letting everybody in Texas know that we know how much you have suffered over the past few days, and we know the enormous challenges that you've been dealing with because of lack of access to power for the past couple of days. And it's exactly because of that that we've had everybody and every agency in the state of Texas who focuses on power working around the clock to make sure that they were going to provide to you the power that you need and the power that you deserve. And I want to thank everyone who has been working around the clock across the state of Texas for the past 24 hours. And because of their work, I'm able to tell you this. Since our press conference yesterday, power has been restored to nearly 2 million homes across Texas. There continue to be approximately 325,000 Texans without power. However, those without power are not without power because of the lack of ability to generate power. Instead, those without power are being impacted either by power lines that are down or the need to manually reconnect the premises to power. So as of this press conference right now, there are no outages of power across the state of Texas because of lack of generation or lack of the ability to generate power. That said, I also want to be clear with Texans, because you need to know, there will be more cold temperatures in various regions across the state of Texas tonight. ERCOT will continue to work to manage the power to ensure that power will not go down in residential areas across the state, but we still have to deal with the uncertainty of what is going on at the power generation facilities. We hope and anticipate no location will be without power tonight. The good news is we are starting the evening with every residence in the state of Texas not lacking the generation of power. Also, I am told, as it concerns the power companies that do the repair of the power lines and as well as the connection to houses, that every available repair truck has been dispatched to repair those down power lines. Know that the repair of the down power lines and the reconnected, that is not a task that is delegated to the state of Texas. That is a task that is conducted by the power companies that operate in your particular area. That said, Texas agencies will continue to work around the clock with our local partners, with residential areas, with industrial and commercial users, until power is restored to every single location across the state. Now, right now, we are focused on five tasks. First is to continue to use every single tool available to get all power restored to all Texans. I have already issued waivers and taken executive actions to expedite that process. Earlier today, I had a call with energy providers to work on additional ways to ensure that we get more power to people in the state of Texas. And they have shared with us already ideas and action plans that we will be able to take to ensure that oncoming power. Second, we need to ensure that we use every tool possible to get water restored to our fellow Texans. I also had a call earlier today with water providers to work on additional ways to expedite getting clean water to Texans. We are in the process, as we speak, of evaluating waivers as well as executive orders that can be used to speed up that process. In the aftermath of the phone call we had earlier, we did receive an abundance of ideas from those local water providers. They've been provided to Toby Baker, who is the executive director of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. He and his team, as well as a team of lawyers, are working on strategies to make sure that we will be able to swiftly address water challenges. Third, we are organizing efforts to help Texans who are challenged by broken water pipes. Along those lines, today, I am making a formal request of the President for a major disaster declaration. If granted, this will give Texans the ability to apply for individual assistance from FEMA. That individual assistance will assist them with funding to restore damage to their homes to the extent that it is not covered by private insurance. In addition to that, continue to work with VOADS as well as faith-based organizations to assist families who live in residences who may be impacted by broken pipes, because we know the magnitude of that challenge and we want to provide people and resources to help you be able to respond to that challenge. Fourth, we are organizing the process of getting aid to Texans in need. Part of that is the efforts already undertaken and continuing by the Texas National Guard to assist those in need and either getting them to warming centers or helping to set up warming centers or providing them whatever else they may need. We also continue to increase the number of warming centers across the state. To find out where a warming center is located, go to www.tdem.texas.gov/WARM. I'll do that again. To find out a warming center near you, go to www.tdem.texas.gov/WARM. We've also had many generous Texans, as we always do, who inquire about how they can help. And I want to give them some specific ideas. One is to help in providing food to those who need the food. A way you can do this is to go to this website location, www.feedingtexas.org. And I will spell that out. It's www.feedingtexas.org. Additionally, for other supplies other than food, we always encourage people to work with the Red Cross. And you can locate them also on the internet at www.redcross.org. Spelled out, that's www.redcross.org. Fifth, we have already begun the process to make sure that events like this never again happen in Texas. And that starts with reforming the agency in charge of electric reliability in Texas, which is ERCOT. What happened this week to our fellow Texans is absolutely unacceptable and can never be replicated again. And it's especially unacceptable when you realize what ERCOT told the state of Texas. They said 5 days before the winter storm hit, the ERCOT CEO assured ERCOT, and I quote, "We're ready for the cold temperatures coming our way." He said that ERCOT had issued a notice to power plants to ensure that they were winterized properly. And ERCOT's annual winter assessment, which is designed to ensure that the state is prepared, assured the public that there would be enough power to meet peak demand this winter. ERCOT failed on each of these measures that they said they had undertaken. Texans deserve answers about why these shortfalls occurred and how they're going to be corrected, and Texans will get those answers. And that's exactly why I have issued an executive order that added emergency items to the legislative session, asking the legislature to investigate what happened at ERCOT that led up to and during the course of the response to this winter storm. But there's more than that that must be done. to prevent Texas from going without power again. So today, I'm adding more emergency items to the legislative session. First, I'm asking the legislature to mandate the winterization of generators and the power system. Second, I'm calling for the funding needed to ensure that this winterization and modernization occurs. Now, I've already been in multiple discussions with both Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick, as well as Speaker Dade Phelan, and with the chairs of the relevant committees that will be in charge of these efforts. That includes Senator Hancock and Representatives Goldman and Patty. The last thing I'll say is this. Everyone knows how challenging the past few days have been for our fellow Texans. I want everyone to know that all of us in the state of Texas believe it is completely unacceptable that you had to endure 1 minute of the challenge that you faced. All of us agree on the necessity of action, not just the action taken to restore your power, but to action to ensure that you never have to endure anything like this ever again. That's why, for one, with each passing hour, we will continue to ensure that your power will be restored and that your water challenges will be resolved. Now, we know because of the storm that will continue to sweep across parts of Texas tonight that we are not yet out of this, but we're closer to this challenge being behind us. We will not stop until normalcy is restored to your lives. Until that moment comes, though, I ask all Texans to continue your efforts to take the proper precautions that are needed to stay safe and to stay warm. At this time, I will pass it to Chief Nim Kidd, the Chief of the Texas Division of Emergency Management.
Thank you, Governor. Yesterday, we went through a long list of resources that are available, and I'm here to tell you that the road conditions are improving and will continue to improve as we watch this weather go out of the state. Additional personnel are on the streets from all of the agencies that have been represented yesterday. I want to talk quickly about water. You've heard that power has come back up. We want to keep pushing power. But water we classify in three different groupings. We have emergency drinking water, we have industrial or institutional water, and agriculture water. Emergency drinking water, we're working with our local partners, our private sector partners, and FEMA to push additional water to every county in the state of Texas right now. A big challenge will be the industrial water. Most of the time when we have a hurricane or a tornado that goes through and takes out water to a hospital or water to a city or community, there are other hospitals or cities or communities that can bring us additional resources. The place we are right now with almost every single water institution impacted, not only from the frozen lines in our homes, but the frozen lines in the streets that are running institutional water, water will continue to be a challenge. To meet that challenge, we're working with our federal partners and our partners from other states. I've talked to people from California and Florida today, and a lot of the states in between, to offering assistance that will be coming this way. We need to continue to conserve water. We need to be careful with the use of water, and together we'll get through the water challenges. We are asking for additional generators. We have generators that are from our state agencies that are going out in the field, and we have generators from the federal generator package. We will continue to work that, but I need to tell you, putting a generator on a church or a nursing home or a hospital that doesn't already have one and is not built for one is not as simple as going to Lowe's or Home Depot and plugging in an extension cord and getting power. So we will continue to work with those facilities that did not prepare ahead of this storm to have the transfer switches installed, to have the right connections and the right cables in place. We will continue to work with them to bring those online. We're also bringing in meals ready to eat. So we will be distributing meals ready to eat with water in cooperation with our cities and counties across the state. We're up to over 331 warming centers. The map is behind me here on the screen. Behind y'all on the screen. Again, the governor mentioned the website, tdem.texas.gov/warm. We will continue to bring on additional warming centers, working very closely with our federal partners here at both of the tables to make sure that the major disaster declaration will be met. Remember, that is by law, fiscal thresholds that have to be met. There's a number of homes that have to demonstrate damage, It's been hard to demonstrate that damage. We can presume it at this point. We will continue to push that. We're in constant communication with our federal partners for the major disaster declaration. And I want to thank all of our VOADs, our volunteer organizations that are active in disaster, whose homes and businesses have also been impacted by this, but are still out serving fellow Texans. If you get a chance and have the ability to volunteer, please work with one of our existing structures to volunteer. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Chief. And now the state official who is in charge of response to water-based issues, Toby Baker, the executive director for the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality.
Thank you, Governor. Quick update. So out of approximately 7,000 public drinking water systems across the state of Texas, due to lack of power, frozen or broken pipes, or high demand, 797 of those water systems are reporting some sort of issue. Currently, about 725 are under a boil water notice, and that affects about 13 million Texans. Water systems are operated and maintained by local entities, so we are systematically reaching out across the state to identify systems that are experiencing problems. Many have already reported to us, but we are working hand in hand with local water systems to find ways to bring them back online as quickly as possible. This includes engineering solutions and regulatory solutions like the governor alluded to earlier. So that includes local governments, private entities, and utility districts. If you have a question or a problem with your water, you need to contact your local water provider because they are the ones working on that system. That would be found on your utility bill, or you can find it online. It's very important. So for example, if you live in the city of Austin, you need to be contacting the city of Austin to work on your water issues. We are currently reaching out to a number of laboratories across the state to make sure that they are ready for the sampling that will be needed to lift those boil water notices. We are also partnering with the EPA and bringing in mobile labs from out of state to assist. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. We'll take a few questions.
Hey, Governor, you raised $153 million in the last 7 races that you've run, of which $30 million came from oil and gas. How can we trust you there, boys? You seem to be beholden to oil and gas. One individual actually in the town of Ridley, how can we trust you there for the sake of human future to allow for more energy coming from, say, green energy, which you on Fox News said was responsible for this outage? How can we trust you to actually deliver
I received even more from residential property owners and people who live in the residences that I've been working around the clock to help.
That's your answer. That's it.
Next question, sorry. Next question, Wes.
Governor, with the supply chain of getting food and other items to places, some of the big stores, there have been lines for out the door, and now that people are getting some of their power back, we'll be looking to restock those refrigerators that have undoubtedly gone bad. What does the process look like to ensure that supply chain gets reestablished?
So I'll answer this in part, and then I'll have Chief Kidd answer in part. So the question is about all the people who are either in line to get food or need to access food. And there's are multiple answers to this. We know from our conversations with private food providers, such as grocery stores, for example, that their stocks were running down. And we know about what they're working on as we speak to replenish those stocks. One thing that will aid in replenishing those stocks is the fact that the roads are more passable. And we know that over the next 24 hours, that grocery stores as well as restaurants, we saw a lot of people lined up for fast food restaurants, for example. They will have more food available to them. Second, there are others who need access to food. And we are working with local as well as some state-based agencies to make sure that we will be providing that food. That goes also hand in hand with my reference to that organization that some Texans want to help out with, and that is people can support this effort by going to www.feedingtexas.org. Let me have Chief Kidd add additional information.
Yep, and Wes, thank you for that question. I think it is important that we share the information. Myself, my team, the governor's office, and his team have been on the phone most of the morning with grocery providers across the state talking to them. You know, let's talk about things we can't control, the weather. Talk about things we can control, our communication and how we communicate with our partners. That's why it's important that we know their distribution points. We're working with TxDOT behind us in order to get those roads cleared. We're working with the utility providers in order to get their stores back up. We want residences first and then quickly come into the industrial so that we can provide those services. We've also talked to FEMA about additional meals ready to eat, that temporary gap if we have to, and had conversations with many of our major food banks across the state today, either by text or cell phone, about the resources that they need. And we will continue to provide additional updates on information, but more importantly, we're going to keep pushing food into this state. I ask, though, that we not hoard food. This is going to get to the point where you take what we need and we will work through this together.
Yesterday you mentioned that there's so many, there's millions of Texans that are under a boil water advisory. If these Texans were to drink that water, what are the repercussions of that? And then you mentioned that there was only 24 hours yesterday that you had to do the bacterial testing. Could that be